Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Redondo Beach Center for Spiritual Living. Well, we know that we're changing lives every time we open our doors, and thank you for being here. But first, we're going to rise and sing our congregational song with Miss Elise Carter, and here we go.
Good morning, everyone. So glad to be here today with you all.
Choosing heaven today. I'm walking the road of spirit right now. I'm choosing heaven today. I'm choosing love today. I'm choosing love today. Oh, I'm walking the road of spirit right now. I'm choosing love today. I'm choosing joy. Choosing joy today. I'm choosing peace today. I'm choosing peace today. Oh, I'm walking the road in spirit right now. I'm choosing peace today. I'm choosing heaven today. I'm choosing heaven today. I'm choosing heaven today.
So this is our official welcome, and I was looking in my notes for something that, oh, here it is. One of the things that we include in the welcome these days is our vision for the minister that we are seeking. So welcome to all of you if you just got here today for the first time. If you're joining us online for the first time, we welcome all. And we're letting you know that we are in the process of finding the absolute perfect senior minister for Redondo Beach Center for Spiritual Living. And before we even started, we had a group of willing volunteers who came together to spiritually set up a vision and a plan so that we could attract that right person to us. And so we are sharing that periodically from the platform to remind everyone to stay in prayer about this very important thing that we're doing. We had a couple of quotations that supported us. One is from the New Testament, from Mark. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And from Ernest Holmes, who is the founder of the Science of Mind that we all study and practice, let our word be spoken with a deep inner realization of love, beauty, peace, poise, power, and the great presence of life. Our purpose is wholeness. Our vision statement, we are an inclusive center, a magnet for creativity, spiritual growth, love, and fun. Our new minister is spirit-centered, empowering, loves the teaching, and is a fantastic manifester who walks the talk. Our new minister is authentic and trustworthy with highly developed management skills. Our new minister is charismatic, inspiring, and poised. Our new minister is approachable, loving, and kind. Our new member is growth-centered and community-involved. So I invite all of you to join me in knowing that we are finding this perfect person that embodies all of the ideals that we are putting out there as part of our vision, to be at home in this center. And I invite you to agree with me and say, so. Thank you very much. Now, let's invite up Mr. Mark, who is going to share announcements with us.
Good morning. Welcome to everybody here in the sanctuary and online. I'm Mark Ruth. I'm president of the Board of Trustees. We have wonderful activities coming up for inspiration and connection. Our women's circle will be meeting today at 12:30 p.m. in the teen room. And tomorrow, our men's group will meet in the foyer at 7 p.m. Reverend Valerie is facilitating a workshop called Creative Visualization on Saturday, April 20th at 10 a.m. Come discover how to harness the full potential of your imagination and intuition. Sign up today and be sure to put it in your calendar, April 20th. Our annual membership meeting is April 21st. After Sunday service, we will be electing members to our Board of Trustees. Join us as we celebrate last year's accomplishments and look to the future. All are welcome to attend. Only members will be allowed to vote. So if you want to become a member, you got to pay your $35 dues. On Sunday, April 28th, we are delighted to have Michael Pascal providing an amazing musical meditation experience with virtuoso pianist Marina Kisla. They will be performing at Carnegie Hall later this year, and we are thrilled to have them here in our sanctuary. Cost is only $35. Tickets are available at the front desk. Looking ahead to the drumming circle, we'll meet the first Sunday in May instead of the last Sunday in April. This will also provide an opportunity to practice for the talent show that will be on Saturday, May 18th. Our Science of Mind class is on Sunday mornings from 10:15 a.m. to 10:45. Join us for a taste of Dr. Ernest Holmes in Living the Science of Mind. We have two great book study groups. Tuesdays, we meet in the foyer at 10 a.m., and our group is reading Spiritual Liberation by Michael Beckwith. Our Zoom book group is reading Quantum Healing by Deepak Chopra. They meet at 9:15 a.m. on Wednesday. All are welcome to join these groups at any time. Join us for our informal but engaging midweek service on Wednesdays at 11 a.m. Reverend Valerie Reeves is speaking this week. Looking ahead, check out the flyer at the activity table for our next Science of Mind class with Reverend Kathy Sinfeld. It is an in-person class for 5 weeks here in Richelieu Hall, starting on Thursday, May 9th, and it's called Keys to Manifesting. A big thank you to all our wonderful volunteers. We couldn't do it without you. We are especially looking for people to join our tech team. Come help with cameras, slides, and video broadcasting. Now we have some meditation music to lead us into our invocation. Thank you.
Every thought, our every word is a prayer. And so we turn our thoughts and words to the idea of the love that is in this place, the love that wells between us, and the love that we know that we grow into as we consciously understand and more understand the size and the magnitude of love and the power that we are born into, the power that we are part of, that's always bigger than we can imagine, and yet knowing that we can grow into that every day. So I call on all of this idea to manifest in this room and beyond today, as the power and the presence of love moves through every soul in this room and lifts us up, knowing there's always more love, and I'm always motivated by that beautiful idea. I am incredibly grateful to know that there is a power for love, that God is love, and that is the way it always is. So I breathe into this moment again in gratitude and simply allow it to be as I release this word, knowing that it's done. And I agree and say, and so it is.
Good morning. Reverend Katherine's talk today is Rising in Love. All relationships are love in form. In the book Spiritual Fitness, Carolyn Reynolds tells us, we are social beings driven by an urge for connection. We rely upon relationships with others to overcome a sense of separation. You see, we are reflections of one another, and our relationships are like a mirror, reflecting back to us our own beliefs, our own judgments. Do you remember the fairy tale story Snow White?
Yes.
Snow White's vain and wicked stepmother possessed a magic mirror. Each and every day, she would ask it, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all?" And the magic mirror would reply, "Thou, O queen, art the fairest in the land." That is, until one day, when the mirror's reflection changed, and the mirror informed the queen that Snow White was the fairest of them all. The evil queen was livid. Uh-oh. Now, the queen could have used the feedback that the mirror provided her and set about to change in order to become kinder, gentler, and fairer in a genuine attempt to rightfully regain the title of being the fairest in the land. But no. Instead, the queen was determined to have Snow White killed. Ernest Holmes, the founder of Science of Mind, tells us on page 412 of the Science of Mind textbook, "The objective world is but a reflection of our subjective state of thought." And in the book, Living the Science of Mind, he says, "Life is like a mirror, reflecting back to us the images of our own thinking." The mirror is simply something that reflects. You cannot scratch the reflection out of the mirror. If you do not like what you see, do you have enough confidence to believe that you can change it? Are we sometimes like the evil queen, trying to change or even kill what our life is reflecting back to us, instead of changing the image that we're holding up in front of the mirror? Science of Mind teaches us that the only way we're going to change the reflection, and the reflection is the conditions, the situations, the relationships, the effects. So the only way we're going to change the effects is to change the cause. And the cause is our predominant thoughts, beliefs, and feelings. Now, in the fairy tale, it was the seven dwarfs who came to Snow White's rescue. So when we're in the process of creating the life that we desire, we don't want to be grumpy and just complain about what is wrong, nor do we want to be bashful or too afraid to take charge and direct the law wisely. We certainly don't want to bury our head and ignore the problem as if we're asleep. No, we're no dopey, because we know that we are equipped with divine intelligence, like any good doc, and we can diagnose the problem. And we will be so happy once we treat and move our feet in the direction of our greatest good. And that, my friends, is nothing to sneeze about. Please repeat after me. I am an intelligent and responsible image maker. My life is a reflection of love, joy, and harmony. And so it is. Off to work we go.
I am one with God, as God lives in you, God lives in me. Not a sacrifice, but a surrender to love, abiding in love. And now the calling is divine, to reveal and not deny that we're standing in presence. Remember who you are, made with the light of all the stars, and shine with the essence of God. You and I were born deserving. Of a
God, as God is in all, God is in us. Not a God without, but a Spirit within, always within.
Remembering who you are. Thank you so much, Elise. That was just lovely. Thank you. Remembering who we are, it's a great calling. And rising in love is the idea behind rising to more than we are in our own belief. But remembering who we are is that rising that we are talking about. I created the title Rising in Love for a couple of reasons. The theme for the year in CSL is grand rising, the grand rising. And it's a rising in consciousness is my way of thinking about it. But rising in love is because I do believe that love is the essence of God that we most are drawn to. Ernest Holmes talks about love more in the science of mind than any of the other qualities of God that we do talk about. And yet, this idea of that was percolating in my mind. And then one day, I was thinking about the idea of this, and I happened upon a quote from Ernest Holmes, which it was just short, and so I decided to find it in the textbook, assuming it was in the textbook. And I did find it, and then I went on and read something else that I think inspires me even more for the message that I am sharing. He says that love is the grandest healing power on earth. It is our reason for being. And he says that that is why all of us need to have something or somebody to love. Now, when I say somebody to love, maybe you hear the soundtrack of Freddie Mercury and Queen in your head. If you do, then you're hearing the one that plays in my head, Somebody to Love. So thinking about this, I was actually listening to a podcast. It was the week before. And I started listening to it when I was going somewhere. And it started with an interview of a man that was well known, and I actually didn't know the person, but I was listening and he was being interviewed, and as it turns out, this is a very famous person that I didn't know. But he tells the story of when he was a boy and his family had moved to France. They're a Jewish family, and they were living in Paris when the Germans moved in the early 40s. So they had to follow the curfews and wear the yellow star. So he's a young boy, and so he was playing at someone's house. It's a Christian friend, he says, and he stayed too long. And so he was hurrying home. He was only a few blocks away, but before he left, he turned his sweater inside out so that his yellow star wouldn't show. And he's hurrying very quickly, moving through the streets, and he turns down one street, and it's empty, except for this soldier that's coming toward him. And so as he looks at the soldier, he tries to keep his head down and walk very quickly, but he realizes that the soldier is wearing the black uniform that he had been told to fear, because this is the SS. So he was petrified, and as he gets closer to the soldier, the man beckons him to him. So he goes over, and the soldier grabs him and hugs him and lifts him up and holds him for a bit. And then he puts him down, and he starts very emotionally telling him things in German, and then he pulls out his wallet, and he shows the boy a picture of another boy. And then he gives him some money and he tells him to go home. It's Daniel Kahneman is the man's name, and he was called Danny then. And so he hurried home, and he was grateful but confused about what had happened. And he later says that, I realized when I got home that it was true what my mother told me, that people are complex and interesting. Daniel Kahneman talks about that incident in his life and this podcast, and it's also a story that he told when he received a Nobel Prize, because it was the turning point in his life. It directed his life, that people are endlessly complicated and interesting. He became a behavioral psychologist and explored the reasons why we do things. And he actually focused on what things are called heuristics as well as biases. Heuristics are these sort of cognitive shortcuts that our brain has. One example is that if you give any group of people a list of happenings, accidents, disasters, and ask to rank them in terms of their fear, the first one that people put are airplane crashes. And they're not the thing that we should fear the most. It's actually automobile accidents. If we're picking, far more people get hurt, damaged, killed than in airplane accidents. But for some reason, because they're so splashy and because they're all over, our minds have picked up on that, and we think of it as our fear. People get on the plane, and there's, in every plane load, there are people that are afraid of that, and yet we get in our cars and go places all the time. And that's a heuristic. That's that shortcut your brain takes to say this is the worst. So he studied these kinds of things, and he studied other kinds of reasons why people do things. And in the course of doing that, he got the Nobel Prize, not in psychology, but in economics, because he studied things that make us choose to do things, choose to buy things. And how many of us choose to do buy things that are at eye level, for example? Well, that's something that research has done, and that's the kind of work he did. And up until that point, everyone, economists, assumed that we all behave rationally. And guess what? We don't. We don't behave rationally. So when we are thinking of what love motivates us to do, we don't necessarily think in terms of find somebody to love. But the truth of the matter is, the more that we embrace a concept, we're teaching ourselves how to embrace love. It is a practice, and that, to me, is the motivation behind rising in love. Ernest Holmes talked about how our thinking around love, and he said that love is a motivating factor in many aspects of our lives, that we should consider that when we look at things, when we see things, we want to see with that inner way that we want things to be, even if the appearances are different from that, that we want to see that. And if we can hold that inner vision, then it will outpicture in our lives. But what is also true is that we need to remember to keep our eye focused on those things that are pure, are uplifting, and not be distracted by what's going on in the world if it deters us from staying in that loftier thing. And then he warns, he said, you do this not just, if you can't do this for lofty reasons, then do it for selfish reasons. Because if you focus on anger and on hate and on hold anything, resentment, anything against any living soul, then you cannot fulfill that love quest. God is love, and God cannot hear the prayer, he says, of someone who does not love. He is very adamant in the places that we keep our minds not on what our shortcuts take us, not on the things that may influence us, but keep it lifted up. Allow the love in our life to rise. And it's interesting how easily we are influenced by appearances. I remember once someone told me just a factual thing, and I said, but that's not true. And I had happened to have read about it the day or two before. Oh, yes, it is. It's absolutely true. Well, I whipped out my computer and looked up something and said, see, it's not true. And the response was, well, he acted like he knew what he was talking about. That's a true story. And so we want to make sure that we allow ourselves to be open to the possibilities. If it conflicts with the things that Ernest Holmes says we should do as opposed to aligning with the things we should avoid. If for selfish reasons, he said, you should avoid anger and hate and holding resentment against any living soul. How often are we doing that? And I know that whatever the answer is, we can do it less today than we did yesterday. And then when we take that sum, it's less, we are lifted up more today than we were last week. That is what rising in love means to me. That you affirm for yourself for every day the way you want to be, the way you want to be in the world. And what he says is if we could see it on the inside, that inner vision within, he says, then it inevitably happens that the outer vision moves into exactly into focus with our inner vision. Now, this is true of any principle that we choose to embody. from prosperity to abundance to all of these things, but the greatest of these is love. And we start with that, and we're lifted up to start with. There's another song, Love Lifted Me Up, Where I Belong. I tell you, there's soundtracks throughout this. But that is, they're actually for a reason. I think that we put into music those emotional things that are most important, because Ernest Holmes says that this is the essence of what we embody, that we, our whole being is made and mixed with love. Circling back to Daniel Kahneman, I did hear in the podcast that I'd almost forgotten it because I did some research on him later to find more things about him, but he also talked about that incident that happened, and it changed and gave direction to his life. He said, you know, it was just an accident that I happened to be on that street that day. And of course, in my mind is screaming, no, it's not. We are consciousness, and we pull into us those things that are important. It changed the direction of his life, and he's thinking that's an accident. But that's the kind of psychologist he was. He was a behavioral psychologist, and he couldn't demonstrate in spreadsheets exactly how that happened. He goes on and talks about partnerships with different psychologists. He loved collaborative work. And it was just an accident that I met this man who was just my soulmate for about 15 years, and we collaborated. I'm thinking, no, it's not. So even though he was changed by that incident, I wonder now. See, what I heard when he told that story is that this man, this SS man, was a father who loved his son and who missed his son, and he could not see a boy that was Jewish and breaking curfew. He saw his son because that's the love that was coming through him, and he saw that, and he couldn't see anything else at that point. And that is what that strong emotion does for us. When we know that and know that to the core of our being, it allows us to lift ourselves up with the idea of the love that we're embodying. And so that coming back to that and thinking about how he has done wonderful things in the world, the man is a well-known psychologist. He has lectured at Berkeley, Stanford, in England, Harvard. He ended up at Princeton. He is just a very gifted scientist, if you will, in psychology. And I like to know that within him, that power of love that he propelled him to start with is working through that. And he has had a grand life. He actually passed less than 3 weeks ago. He was 90 years old and had a fantastic life. And so all of us can take those things that we love and allow them to lift us up, the people that we love, the relationships that we develop. These are what's most important in all of our lives and how we grow in that idea. So, in closing, I want to say that the idea of love rising within me is like a primary motivation at this point in my life. And seeing how it develops and how it grows in those people that I love, my grandchildren, my own children, as well as my friends. And that is just part of the way life works. It's such a web. And we affect everyone when we grow ourselves. Do you believe that? Yes. We affect everyone around us when we have this message that we can embody. And if all of us in this room can do that, even to some degree, oh my gosh, there's nothing that we cannot do. There's nothing we cannot change. And we grow more and more with the commitment that we do that. And so I'm going to ask you to share with me. I choose to rise in love. I like the way you said that. Let's do that again. I do believe that, and I am grateful to embody those words in this moment. It's a very, very strong gratitude. Thank you for being here and for rising in love all together. And so it is. Thank you. I want to welcome up the amazing Elise Carter to give us one more song. Thank you. Have another love soundtrack that's playing in our head. Thank you, Elise Carter. And the ushers are coming down. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a grand opportunity to be able to share what we have. And it is an act of love to be able to share. Not just love, but our worldly things, because I think it was Raymond Charles Barker said that money is God in action. And so let's put some action into all of the needs. This is a wonderful place. We've been here 77 years through the gracious giving of so many people. And that includes you. You and I have inherited a grand, grand experience, and we are giving back. And so as we share our offering, our affirmation, keep those words in mind, because it's got love in there. Divine love consecrates my gift. It goes forth to heal, to bless, and to prosper all those who give and all those who receive. I rejoice in the sharing of my good, and I release my gift with love, and so it is. Yes.
Grateful for the morning, grateful for the sunlight on my face, grateful for the feeling, grateful for the knowing, grateful for the love that's in this place, grateful for believing that God is all there is, that God is all there is. Grateful for the morning, grateful for the sunlight on my face, grateful for the feeling, grateful for the knowing, grateful for the love that's in this place, grateful for believing that God is all there is, that God is all there is, God is all there is.
For your giving. We appreciate it more than maybe you realize as you put your envelope in the plate. And now is the time when we're asking the practitioners and any ministers we have to come forward. And this is the time when our practitioners are in front. They're inviting you to step down and avail yourself of their prayer work. We are a teaching, sides of mine is teaching and practicing, and we do prayer. And so you're invited to come and have that wonderful experience of prayer. And we are now going to rise and sing the peace song. And knowing that it's good, I'm sorry, they're cold as ice.